Futures and options on futures trading involve substantial risk and is not a suitable investment for all types of investors. Past results are not necessarily indicative of future results. When I use the word I in this video, it refers to what I teach in my charting course or what I offer in my twice daily oral and written updates. Prices shown on charts and quote boards are in real time and take into account all known activity up to this point in time. And if you'd like to read more of this disclaimer, simply hit the pause key on your video player.
Good day. Ira Epstein of Linen Associates with your metals market update for this Wednesday, the 28th of June, 2017, just after 4 p.m. Central Daylight Time. So as we can see, a small gain today in most of the metal markets, right across the board, in fact. That's in part due to the continued break of the dollar, the euro rallying up, the British pound rallying. The big event of the day is in Portugal. There's been a forum going on of European central bankers, and one after the other keeps coming out and saying, today was the Bank of England, that instead of things on pause, they're getting ready to raise rates. Mario Draghi came out and tried to clean up his act from yesterday. The market didn't buy into it. He is still talking of tightening rates after this current QE program ends this year. So they first dropped the euro as he was trying to clean it up. I happened to be up really early this morning watching this, and then the market came roaring back as the market realized it was a cleanup act, not a real change of policy. There is a policy change coming, and that's a watershed event. You've got to keep that in the back of your mind. This means that the U.S., which had been raising rates for, what, the past year and a half or so, now we're having a harder time raising them. We're doing them, but the market's really resisting it, hence the curve yield flattening. And now the other currencies are going to start raising theirs. They're about a year and a half behind us, as I said. So in looking at that, they're starting to get the bids. That's the easy way to look at it. And the safe haven currency, which is the yen, is feeling selling pressure with the dollar because they want to keep theirs just where they're at, if you will. They don't intend on raising rates. So the others, well, higher interest rates, better rate of return on monies invested in that currency. All right, so in the gold market, as we look at the weekly chart, I've decided to put back on the weekly 18-week moving average. And in my gold report, this is the number that I wrote about, and I wrote the report last week. And as you can see, you're spending time right against that. And these are what I'll call the current, if you will, you can argue, is this the current uptrend line? What is the uptrend line? I could bend it a little more and put it in here. It depends how you want to play it. But we're in that zone right now as to where the market's squishing. I could move this line up and have it intersect right there if I wanted. Both ways are correct because when you're drawing chart lines, there is no magic to it. It's what looks like it's fitting. When I come to an area chart of just closes, you still have a pattern of lower highs, lower lows, although this particular move here ended the lower and low pattern, but you still have that pattern of lower highs. So the market, until you can get back over 1250, 640, I'm going to call it still in a pattern that is overall bearish. The market is now consolidating in this zone right through here. Let's call it from 1260 to the high 1230s, back and forth. And that low 1230s, well, it's not low, it's the 1236.50 number to 1260. You get to see that really easy when you put on your swing lines and you activate so that it prints for you the current numbers. By the way, on my swing line, you can also activate it so all of the numbers, everywhere you have one of these, come on the chart. I find that a bit annoying, but when you're learning them, it's not a bad way to do that, so you get a feel for what's going on. So if you're a chartist, as I am, and you're looking for what makes up a trend, well, the definition of an uptrend's higher highs, that's with an S on it, higher lows, another S. You don't have that. You have a higher high singular and a lower low singular. That's no trend at all. When I look at where you're at in relation to the 18-day average of closes, which we'll call 18-day moving average of closes, MAC, you're under it. And the battleground has been the 100-day average. The market is trying to stay under it, not to get back over it. It's trying to stay under it as the market's still trying to stay in the bearish camp. If you go to the Bollinger Bands, which are these black lines, they offer theoretical support and resistance. The fact that they keep dropping down and not yet turning up means if the market, because the bias is down, decides to break, could be headed towards that lower number. In terms of momentum, today's an important event. You lost the embedded reading. Now, let me show you what I mean. if you take a look right here at these numbers, I don't think you'll disagree. Both numbers are under 20, both numbers under 20, both numbers under 20. Got it? Now, all of a sudden, the red number is over 20. That's called the loss of an embedded reading. It can only gain back the reading tomorrow. So unless it gets back under 20 tomorrow, you have to start the whole process over. It can dive over it, say, on Friday. Who cares? It's got to stay 3 days more under it. So tomorrow's the key day. The loss of momentum often means price and the 18-day average, in this case, will come together. Why the 18? Because on the day it's lost, you're already at the 100. If the market were lower, you're looking for the most, the closest of those two numbers. In this case, it's at the 100, so it'd be 1262.90. On the gold ETF, you're not there. The momentum is still embedded. Both numbers are still more than 3 days under that, and they're riding the 100-day average. So here you've got a pattern of higher lows and higher highs, so the trend's up, but the bias is down because you're closing under the 18-day average, and momentum is locked in bearish. So the bears have the overall control, and this rules the day. As long as you have an embedded reading, all the rest on the chart takes a backseat to this. Get that number over 20, and the odds favor you're going back, in my opinion, to 119.91. On the GDX, which is the mining ETF, the pattern is bearish. Lower highs, lower lows. It's got itself in a funny spot because you're not getting momentum turning down. Momentum is turned up. So price action down. If you believe that momentum leads price, then this correction should be short-lived and the market should come back up. The resistance, 2258, to knock out the bear trend, you've got to hit 2280, a difficult chart. The gold-silver ratio is in a continuation of correction. Now, it had gone dramatically higher from the 66 range up to up here, the 75 and a fraction. Now it's pulling back in, but it's still a pattern that's got, if you look at it, higher highs and higher lows until you close back under that low. So overall, the trend is still up but in a corrective mode. In the silver, you've lost the embedded reading. Now, let me show you this one because it's important. Here you are on Monday. Today is now Wednesday. You're still embedded. Yesterday, you lose the embedded reading. Remember what I said, it has to gain it back the next day or it's game over, and I look for price and the 18-day average to come together. You did not get it back together. Whether it hits that 18 or not, that is what my rule says, so I'm looking for upside momentum in the market to carry it. Is the market a buy? Cannot be a buy when prices are under the 18-day average, but it can be a short cover. Get out if you're there because the odds favor price is going to come up on you. In the copper market, you're still very much in the bull camp with higher highs, higher lows. Now, you're running the upper Bollinger Band. Almost every day you're hitting it. You're refusing to close over it, which is fascinating because that means the market just staying in that buy mode. It is overbought. It can correct at any time, but there, other than being overbought, there's nothing bearish on that chart. In the platinum market, you still have a market that is laying down. Now, how many days in a row under 20? Well, we have today, day before, and the day before. So we're fully embedded. Until you lose that number, the odds favor what? Prices are going to try to work themselves lower. So we'll see if that is the case. It rules the day. You don't need a trend in the swing line. You have the bias to the downside. So until that's lost, that's how I'd be reading the chart. In the palladium market, you've got the pattern of lower highs, lower lows. It is bearish and it closed under the 18-day average and momentum is down. Therefore, until the market gets back over 867.20, this is a bearish chart pattern. If the market can extend the break, 834 roughly, the lower Bollinger Band. If it clears 867.20 and doesn't make a lower low than 845.40, you could end up with a pattern of higher lows, and if you take that number out, higher highs, which would call for 881 roughly. I'm just rounding the number up. Before I get too far, did I mention this is my last video, and we've got other charts we're going to review. This is my last video until the morning of July 5th. I'm taking a vacation. So be ready for that. We won't be back here. I will be keeping up with the markets, but not really doing an awful lot. Vacation should be a vacation. In the September dollar index, we have a market with a higher high and a lower low. What else? The market's oversold. It's outside of the Bollinger Band. So I'm excited that maybe this is a trading top now getting in place and the dollar's going to work lower, but the setup isn't right for a new sell configuration. If you're looking at, do you have a trend? No, because you got the higher high and lower low. You're under the lower Bollinger Band. But if the watershed event has occurred, this high right now here at the 97.51.5, that is a number that I'd be circling on my chart that shouldn't be violated if my thought process is right. I want to remind you about my charting course because the promotion on it ends this month of June. Now, if you haven't bought my course, let me explain what I do. You're seeing some of the different studies here. Swing lines, Bollinger Bands, window envelopes, slow stochastics. I forgot which one I didn't mention just now, probably moving averages. They're all in there with my way of looking at them. Now, you see some moving averages here. Folks, you see half of what's in the course on moving averages alone. I add more moving averages. And then I teach you how to use them and the logic of using them and where they fit in. Moving averages of highs and lows fit in. What's the rule for using them? Slow stochastics. And here's the beauty. What I do is going to take you to the next level. The course gets you set in one area. Give you an example. When I come back, I'm going to teach pivot points. And you're going to see an advertisement come up from it. But one of the keys to pivot points is slow stochastics, in my opinion. Therefore, I'm going to teach you an in and out method, at least my interpretation of it, and you'll be able to see it. So how do we get that done for you? Well, if you buy the course, you get the basics. The course was in December, $69.95. A year ago, it was near $200. The new course that I created for the Christmas market, and it was a total new course. Every chapter redone, everything redone, new ideas, everything I bring in. I wanted a Christmas special. That's gone up to $99.95, almost a 50% increase, right? I'm telling you now I'm going to raise the price again. But with the words IRA20, you can get the course now for $79.95. No shipping, no handling, because it's